Ukraine Today is talking about the tragedy of Malaysia Airlines flight MH17. And today, we have a very special guest. A person who lost both of his parents in the sky over eastern Ukraine. Mr. Paul Gard, joining us by video link from Brisbane, Australia. Mr. Gard, welcome to Ukraine Today, and many thanks for joining us on such a short notice.
No problems.
Mr. Gard, first of all, please accept our sincerest condolences on your loss. A year ago, Malaysia Airlines flight MH17 was carrying both of your parents from a six-week European vacation back home. They were supposed to land in Kuala Lumpur and then catch a connecting flight to Brisbane, where you were supposed to meet them and pick them up from the airport. Mr. Gard, can you tell us what was happening to you and your brother and sister on July 17th last year when you learned that an aircraft, a commercial airliner which was shot over eastern Ukraine, was the very same plane which was carrying both of your parents back home?
Sure, it was a difficult day, obviously. It started with me being woken up by my sister calling me. She had seen the news and had heard that a Malaysia Airlines plane had been shot down. She immediately feared that it might have been the plane carrying our parents, so I had to go and look at the itinerary, and once I saw the flight number, I knew it was a very bad day.
Mr. Gard, I read your story in the Guardian article by Ms. Gay Alcorn, who actually helped us contact you. The story was from September last year, when you came to Melbourne to collect the bodies of both of your parents. And in this article, you said something which impressed me and which struck me, and I'm sure a lot of the readers as well who read it. And you said in that article that you're seeing a peaceful resolution of the conflict in Ukraine. For you, it was a higher priority than bringing home the bodies of your parents. Can you tell me why did you say so?
Well, in my mind, it was the conflict that caused the death of my parents. I blame the conflict rather than the combatants, simply because there's obviously terrible things that happen in wartime, and I'm working on the assumption that nobody intended to bring down a passenger plane. So, therefore, I feel that it was the conflict itself that was really the cause of the problem, and also just the horrible violence and the loss of innocent lives in Ukraine, on top of the loss of all those lives on the plane, it really made me quite upset.
In your mind, is international community and the world as a whole doing enough to stop the conflict, which is actually a full-fledged war here in Ukraine, right now, almost a year after this tragic incident, which was basically a wake-up call for the entire world, telling that there is a real full-fledged war raging here in eastern Ukraine. So in your opinion, is enough being done?
No, I think there should be more being done. I knew when MH17 happened that it might cause the international community to put a lot more pressure on the people there to stop fighting and come to some sort of agreement. Obviously, there's been problems in implementing the Minsk agreement, so I do hope that both sides will fulfill that agreement and stop the skirmishes that continue to happen on the frontier there. And I hope that Ukraine can get control of its borders and some sort of compromise negotiated solution be reached.
Paul, as you know, in the first days following the crash of MH17, there were a lot of controversies surrounding the access to the crash site by international search and rescue teams. Myself, along with a lot of other journalists, we were there at the crash site, and we were seeing these controversies firsthand. We were seeing when the separatist leaders were making the public statements that they are welcoming any and all international investigators to the crash site. Yet at the same time, we're hearing reports from these teams that their security was not guaranteed by the very same separatist leaders. So when you were back in Australia, again, thousands of kilometers away from the conflict and thousands of kilometers away from the crash site, and you were receiving these mixed messages, you were receiving this little reliable information, what were you thinking about what was happening with the bodies of your parents, which were there in eastern Ukraine?
Well, my reaction is probably different to most of the other families of the victims, because personally, the bodies don't have very much emotional significance to me. So I was much more focused on what's going on with the war and how can we try to get this war to a peaceful resolution, because once my parents had been killed, I mean, for me, it was like a cremation in the sky, you know, that the bodies don't mean very much to me. So I feel for the other families that really did want to get their loved ones' bodies home. For me, it was always a much higher priority that the focus be on trying to stop the fighting.
Mr. Gard, in the early days following the crash, the Russian media, in an effort to shift the blame or trying to infuse as much uncertainty as possible, came up with various theories of what could have happened to flight MH17. And one of the most craziest theories, which all of us heard, was that the plane was already filled with dead bodies and blown over eastern Ukraine specifically to blame the Russia-backed militants and to infuse the situation even more. When you heard this absolutely outrageous theory saying that your parents were never there on this plane, that is, instead of your parents, there were dead bodies already on board that flight, what did you feel then?
I didn't pay much attention to those conspiracy theories, because it was quite clear to me what had happened. And if it is a Buk missile that has brought the plane down, which is the most likely theory I've heard, then I still primarily blame the conflict, because I see it as a function of what was happening there in the war and this hardware being there. I don't believe the people pressing the button intended to bring down a passenger airliner. If they did, obviously that's a different story, but if they didn't, then it's really a function of them being there fighting, trying to bring down military aircraft, and obviously that's a terrible thing, and every aspect of that war is a terrible thing, and it's obviously extremely hard for me to understand the causes being so far away and having not much education on the history. But for Ukraine and Russia to have fallen so far out of friendship when they were part of one country and when they have such strong economic ties, it seemed like a terrible tragedy to me that it could ever have gotten to this.
And so, Mr. Gard, my final question, again, in this very same Guardian article, you said, and I quote, "I think it will change my life." Has this tragedy changed your life?
Yeah, I think this sort of thing has a very big impact on anyone, and everyone who's lost a loved one will experience that effect of having a change in priorities and perhaps a different view on what's important. So, yes, I suspect it has changed my life. My wife and I are expecting a baby in September, our first baby, so that's something positive for us to look forward to, and I guess life doesn't always give you what you expect or what you think it will, but we've made the best of a bad situation, and we've got a lot of support from our friends and family and community, so we're grateful for all the support we've received.
Yeah, the support of the loved ones and of the family is indeed very important. Mr. Gard, many thanks for finding the time and talking to us and sharing your thoughts with us and our viewers. This is Volodymyr Sulhu for Ukraine Today, together with Mr. Paul Gard, the son of two MH17 victims. Thank you for watching us.